you worked hard, he treated you well. If you didn't work hard, you were probably fired. He fired people for many reasons. He fired the entire staff once because he couldn't find his watch.
And I remember going in one day to Nova, and my memory of it is that it was 5 or 6 or 7 o'clock, that sort of time on a Friday evening, just before we were going for our pints to the Henry Grattan. And there was mayhem in Nova. The station had gone off the air. There was something going wrong with the transmitter. And Kerry was running up and down the stairs, and he was giving out socks, and he was firing people left, right and centre. And I walked up the stairs to meet Declan or John or whoever it was, and he said, "Where the fuck are you going?" I says, "I'm just going up to meet." He says, "You're fucking fired." And I says, "But I don't even work here." "Well, you're fucking fired anyway."
"This is ridiculous. It doesn't play. Here am I stuck at number 17 and it doesn't go. You know, we can't play 16 instead. That's
yes,
not
you can.
No, that's not fair. I'm going to wait here patiently until this thing queues up. Then I'm going to find out who played it. And then he's going to be working for Sunshine Radio because he won't be working here anymore." dare me to murder the man who did this.
For somebody I admired to tell me that I could work in his radio station was almost an acknowledgement that someone was saying to me, "Boy, you have a bit of talent." So I think I'll always remember him for that. And I'm actually glad he gave me that opportunity. And I had 5 extremely good years at that station.
I didn't like what his perception was of me, but I admired him as what he did for what he did for the radio business. I admired him for what he did for all our careers, ultimately.
The Nova sound was bigger than ever, and the station continued to attract listeners with its exciting on-air sound and a series of promotions, including the first radio cash giveaway ever seen in Ireland.
Yes. Ruth, are you sitting down?
Yes.
You are caller number 50.
Oh, okay.
You have just won £5,000 in cash from Radio Nova.
I can't remember the turnover figures, but they were very substantial. And I remember paying VAT bills that were the equivalent of probably Sunshine's turnover in a given month. We were paying in VAT. I mean, it was a very substantial business. It paid its PAYE and its PRSI and its VAT and its ground rents and its rents and its... I mean, only the other day I was talking to somebody about the fact that we had amassed up on Three Rock Mountain, and our insurance broker had actually managed to get it insured. I mean, we were a solid business with a solid turnover.
Nova even had its own newsroom featuring presenters like Bob Gallico and Brian Dobson, and run by Chris Carey's future partner, Sybil Fennell.
Sybil Fennell struck me as being extremely professional at what she did. I felt she was a really good newsreader.
She was a very fine newsreader. Like, she's one of the best.
Radio Nova.
It's 11 o'clock, I'm Sybil Fennell, good evening.
And she had a sign off at the end, it was Sybil for Nova. And I remember hearing that, you know, in shops around the city before I even went to the place, Sybil for Nova.
Nova had this open policy of, if you're good and you want to have a bit of a ball, and this is new and innovative and people were very creative, for Bob Gallagher to walk in the door and give his talents, and we all enjoyed him. We all enjoyed his sense of humour, his voice, the fact that he was American, he was an actor. I think he gave a unique, identifiable sound to Radio Nova in those particular heyday times of 82 and 83. Say, Radio Nova is the station with Bob Gallico on it.
The news gathering operation, to use the phrase, was very rudimentary. We really didn't have reporters in the field gathering news themselves. We were basically listening to RTE, to the BBC, reading CFAX and some of the text services, and putting the news together primarily from those sources. Now, as it went on, we did begin to gather some of our own news and do some of our own programmes and do some of our own interviews. But the staple diet, the staple source of news was other news organisations, to be frank.
Politicians, conscious of the substantial younger audience Nova now commanded, were keen to take advantage of whatever airtime was on offer.
I think the smarter political types were copping on to the fact that Nova was delivering the 18 to 25 audience, the audience that they just could not reach. And bit by bit, they started to come on air. Then they started coming on in their droves.
"Hello, this is Seamus Brennan, TD. It's funny, isn't it? But when we have jobs, we tend to forget those who haven't any jobs."
Hello, this is David Andrews. I'm a Dáil deputy for the constituency of Dunleary. I'm asking you to support Radio Nova's project to provide work experience.
I remember one night being out with Kerry, and we were at a function, and he went up and introduced himself to Charlie Haughey. And Haughey was only delighted to have his photograph taken with the guy who owned the biggest radio station in town. But then someone gave out, I think some lefty group gave out, that the government ministers and senior politicians were on Nova. And then, of course, they ran like scalded cats. They were nowhere to be seen. And to be honest, I couldn't really blame them.
But at senior government level, the political noises were less than reassuring. And over at RTE, there was anger bordering on fury, particularly at the fledgling Radio 2.
We couldn't really crack the Dublin audience because it was seen perhaps as being slightly more sophisticated. Nova had that sophistication about it. It had that sound of an American radio station. It had that American jingles. We didn't have them, you know, Radio 2 hadn't come that journey.
Imagine how frustrated these guys were. They were out there in their big offices out in Donnybrook, and they were being beaten by this kind of two-roomed setup almost.
The whole business changed with Nova, and the people who ran Radio 2 at the time, they weren't businessmen or women. They were career civil servants, they were career RT people, and they really didn't know how to do it. And I think it's unfair to them. And I'm not defending them, but it's unfair to them to say they didn't know how to handle it. They just didn't know how to handle it.
As RTE saw it, why should an unlicensed operator be allowed to run riot across their airwaves, hoovering up their audience without paying tax or royalties?
RTE, as in Radio 2 at the time, was paying money for every single song it played. Radio Nova was paying nothing.
As Carey saw it, why should a state-controlled body receiving tens of millions in taxpayers' licence fee income be allowed to offer their customers a substandard product? The lines were drawn for battle.
And I think when we started having this huge effect, economically, making so much money, taking revenue from RTE basically, having the big advertisers on, the big names, having the governments, the politicians on and everything, I think, yeah, pressure, that's when the collision course was inevitable.
Despite claims of interference by Nova's signal with military communications and emergency services by RTE and the PNT department, a claim which was never proven, the real issue lay in the increasing threat to RTE's listenership and the increasing impatience at Montrose.
Possibly true. I think, although there will never ever be any record of that, I don't think anyone will own up to it. But I think if there was probably something of a siege mentality developing, particularly at 2FM in RTE. And that would have been fed up the chain.
But it wouldn't surprise me if RTE was putting, at the time, a lot of pressure on the department to deal with the pirates, because it had gone from the chaotic situation where you had really little mom and pop type broadcasting operations that really probably weren't having a huge economic impact, to the situation where you had a number of super pirates, as they became known. Nova was one of them, Sunshine was another, and there were a number of others, which were, I'm sure, really eating into RTE's revenues. So there was a very urgent commercial imperative, I would have thought, from RTE's point of view, to get the pirates off the air. So it wouldn't surprise me the least if there had been that pressure, and I could see why.
Whatever was the real cause and whoever took the ultimate decision may never be known. But on the morning of May 18th, 1983, Department of Posts and Telegraphs officials moved to close Nova down.
It was a day like any other day.
It's 21 and a half minutes past 8. You were telling me you had a story there for us, Bob.
Who can it be knocking at my door?
And it was a guy in visiting the station, Ray Irwin, and he went upstairs. And I said, would you answer the door and just see who that is and let them in? And he comes down to me and he says, it's the guards and it's the department. And I said, now stop winding me up. You know, Radio Nova is a law to itself. The guardie come in for cups of tea, they come in and visit. They're not here to raid it. Yep, they want to talk to Chris Carey.
And I had to go and talk to them, and they were officials of the PNT, I think it was at the time. Really, I just went down to studio and said, just stay on the air, guys. I'll try and see what's going on.
Can it be knocking at my door?
And there was a very sort of officious sort of guy from the department saying, we want to speak to Chris Carey, we want this radio station off the air. Well, the transmitters are up in Red Farm. Yeah, we know the transmitters are there. We want the keys to location.
Declan was putting out calls for Chris Carey to contact the radio station. Meantime, I was sitting in a car with one of the PNT officials being driven to the transmitter site, or the AM transmitter site.
I heard Bob asking for Chris Carey to go to the radio station. And I said, is this it?